Senator Zeldin? I have everybody. I have everybody. Senator Zeldin?
One of the things you mentioned in your opening remarks with regards to use the term cutting costs, and I'm just hoping you can elaborate a little bit more as to what your plans are to cut costs.
We've done a number of things. First of all, we went back and took a look at all the open procurements we had, all the procurements with vendors, and actually renegotiated some of those. We've streamlined the organization in terms of functions. We've tried to combine them. We've set up a business service center. Each one of the agencies in its historical past would process all of its administrative actions separately. We tried to combine those into one and get the economies of scale of those.
If you don't mind me cutting off, I'll just accept responsibility and ask the question the right way. You're talking about cutting costs in the future. I was wondering what plans you have to cut costs moving forward.
We continue those same efforts, and that's where we're generating an awful lot of the savings in terms of taking a look at different ways to do the same business.
Okay. Just give me like a couple examples of something that is part of your vision going forward to cut costs.
Well, collective bargaining is one. I mean, we need to work jointly with labor and management in terms of ways we can figure out how we can deploy the workforces in a way where we can get better utilization out of them in a way that they want to do it. Collective bargaining agreements aren't a unilateral discussion. They're a negotiation with the union. And in some ways, they come forward with some very good ideas in terms of how to do something better, cheaper, and more effective with our resources. And those are the continuations of those. Many of the efforts that we have already generated $800 million in savings that will build to 1.2 are just extensions of things that we have already done, Senator. So it's not rocket science. It's just attention, focus on the ball, and making sure you're delivering those.
Okay. But are you coming in with any new ideas, you know, outside the box? I know that, you know, Jay Walder, for example, one of the things, you know, as part of his legacy, some of the ways that he found new ways to save money. If you could just elaborate a little more on your vision of new ways to save money for the MTA.
Much along the same lines that he did or Joe Loda did. We've refinanced debt, but that's an ongoing issue. In my 20 years here, we continue to refinance debt and we find better interest rates. We've generated some $1.2 billion in savings in that area alone. That has been an historic trademark of the MTA over 20 years. And we generally take those savings, as we will this time, and reapply them as a down payment for the next capital program. Capital programs are in the order of $29 billion over a five-year period. And if we can generate $1.2 billion in savings to be able to have that as a down payment for the next capital program and keep the work going, that's an example. Some of them are at the collective bargaining table. And I don't really want to do negotiation in public, but there are a number of things that we want to be able to see where we can actually generate savings in concert with discussions with the unions and the labor unions.
One of the things that we read about early in the winter, obviously this is an issue that's been around a long time. Sometimes it heats up a little bit more than others. With regards to platform safety, there's constantly a risk, not only with regards to injuries, but also people throwing trash, which, you know, could start a fire. But what we read, obviously in December, there was some press with regards to having platform doors. And some outside-the-box ways to get the infrastructure put in at little to no cost to the MTA by using media. And I just wondered if you can just share a little bit about, you know, what your thoughts are on what we read about. You know, I guess it was like the November-December timeframe.
Unfortunately, in terms of suicides, whether it's the railroads or the Transit Authority, there are a number of people who, on the order of magnitude of 50 to 70 fatalities a year, that are suicides. So that's a concern. The trash on the trackway is another concern. Newer systems designed to a standard where there is a platform edge door that provides a barrier between the trackway and the station platform for climate control purposes, for safety purposes, security purposes, etc. The way the system was designed, both the commuter rail network and New York City Transit, really wasn't conducive for the installation of those. There's a whole host of issues. Average cost per station is in excess of $1.5 million. To be able to put platform doors up. We did have a company, a foreign company from Asia, come forward because they had done something similar in Seoul, Korea, of at their cost, they would install these platform door systems, and what they wanted was the advertising revenue off the face of this. While we've explored those discussions with them, they wanted to decide which stations they would put these doors at. They wouldn't necessarily put them on an entire line. And so we have some concerns. We will explore it. We've had conversations with them. What we think may be a more promising use of technology is a technology called intrusion detection, where you can use electronics to detect the presence of somebody past a certain point on the platform. And should they be detected on the track, you can set off warning lights or bells and alert train operators if trains are coming into the station and other station personnel to respond to the site. We believe that has a greater chance of being more cost-effective and achieving the same purpose.
Back in 2009, Tom DiNapoli, one of his many audits of the MTA was with regards to personal and miscellaneous service contracts. At the time, he was talking about the contracts growing from $315 million in 2006 to $881 million in 2008. And at that time, he was, you know, he noted that a 10% reduction in the consultant contracts would save $176 million. I just want to know, is that audit still an issue, or is that something that is an opportunity to provide savings?
I think you'd have to ask Mr. DiNapoli if it's still an issue from his perspective. It's one that we are addressing. And when I talked earlier in terms of my cost-cutting efforts that precede me, at least two chairmen, where we're actually bringing consultants in on all levels, whether it's materials, vendor supplies, consultancies, and renegotiating contracts, we're doing that. With the onset of Sandy, though, I will tell you that will grow. And the reason it will grow is we've got some $4.7 billion in recovery money for you to spend. And recovery is restoring the system to the day it was the day before the storm, formal definition. Resiliency, which is to harden the system, make it harder in the event another storm comes our way, order of magnitude $4.1 billion. We do not have enough resources internally to be able to do all that work in any of the agencies. So we're going to have to increase the level of consultancy, contractor services, et cetera, to be able to get that work done. Because it's a lot of people at a lot of different elected levels fought very hard for that money. I don't want to be in a position where we don't apply enough horsepower to be able to spend it.
I know Comptroller DiNapoli has done many audits on, he's done multiple audits on overtime abuse. He's done audits with regards to the real estate portfolio. Every time he comes up with a new audit in the MTA, it seems like he's uncovering new ways to save money. And one of the things that intrigues me is that if you look at the consolidated balance sheets for the MTA, there's a pretty significant cash and investment float. I raised this issue with your predecessor, and I'm just interested in knowing why is the cash and investment float over $1.5 billion? Can the MTA operate with a lower cash and investment float?
We'll look at it. There's been an ongoing dialogue. Just in the case of Hurricane Sandy and the aftermath of it, immediately following it, some of those cash advances were very beneficial to have them on board. We did not want to be in a position that we could not commit resources to be able to spend overtime, bring contractors in an emergency work to get the system restored as fast as we possibly could. And the availability of those cash resources were very critical to that. I'm very comfortable with, and I don't take exception to outside parties that are looking over your shoulder, to have what I call healthy tension dialogue, because in some cases, it forces us to take another look at them. And I think the issue of what's an appropriate size of the cash balance is a healthy discussion we should always have.
How long are you here to serve? I got the impression from your predecessor that he was going to be there a little bit longer than he was.
Which predecessor? The one before him or the one before him?
How long are you going to be around?
Well, I can tell you I'm not going to run for mayor of City, New York. I'm not going to take a job in Hong Kong. As I said in my opening remarks, I'm a transit professional. I got out of school with a degree in systems engineering with a specialization in urban transportation. I've been fortunate enough to be able to do what I like to do as a boy, which is play with electric trains. And I mean that sincerely. It's a very important function. This is probably the premier job in the industry. And to be able to head up the MTA and work with people, if there's one thing that New York stands apart in relation to the other entities in the country, is at the end of the day, the money is provided for doing what is needed to either have a capital program to get work done or provide service to carry 8.5 million people a day. I can't think of a better job to be in, so that's the way I'm interested.
How's the real estate transfer tax collection? I know one of the significant hits that led to the MTA coming to Albany a few years back was a very drastic, over $1 billion cut to the real estate transfer tax collection. Are you seeing that number starting to increase?
We are going to, as part of the whole exercise, to make sure that we're more transparent in terms of our financial dealings. We have a five-year plan that we work in that carries us through, I believe, 2016, 15, end of 15. And we continually report on that plan. A significant milestone every year is the mid-year financial forecast that we give to the board. So on July 24th, through the Finance Committee as well as the board meeting, we'll be giving a report in terms of how well we're tracking against that plan. Revenues, are they coming in up or down? Costs, expenses, are they coming in up or down? Projections looking forward and for the remainder of this year as well as the next year as to where we stand. So it'd be premature for me to talk in detail. However, I do know that real estate revenue receipts were up for a number of months. I believe there were some issues last year with respect to real estate, estate taxes. There may have been an increase in the number of people who were selling or having real estate transactions, but we really need to see at least a quarter or two quarters to see what the pattern will be. But I think you've elaborated very clearly. The problem with real estate taxes is they're very recurring. They go up, they go down, and they're not as sustainable as some of the revenue sources.
Okay. One of a prior hearing that we did during the last session PBA was talking about some communication issues underground, that they're having trouble communicating with each other, with other departments. Have those issues been addressed?
We're addressing them through a number of communication projects. I think you have to separate out. I need to separate out and explain it to you. There's two different, there's the MTA Police Department with respect to the communication system it needs and has to interact with the other counties that have police jurisdictions, as well as what the Transit Bureau has for the New York City Transit System, Transit Bureau of the New York City Police Department. And we've got a number of communication initiatives that are in place to respond to changes in federal legislation, narrow banding of frequencies, because they're selling some of those frequencies, as well as dealing with some of the communication problems that exist throughout the system. So there's a number of projects in place to address those.
I think it's very important for the personnel that they're risking themselves to be in situations where they're losing communication, and for riders and for the public, for those various communication issues to be addressed. And we appreciate a commitment to be able to address those communication problems.
One of the problems we had when we used to have the Transit Police Bureau was the communication. We made tremendous improvements since then. But when you overlayer since 9/11, the issue of terrorism, fast, effective, reliable communication cannot be overstated. So I'm totally agree with you.
Can you update us on the real estate issue? I know that it's been, for the last few years, been trying to consolidate real estate assets, to sell off real estate assets. Can you let us know what's going on with that?
There is an aggressive approach to try to get as much revenue as we can out of real estate. We did reach an agreement with the city under the master lease program to sell the former Transit Authority headquarters at 370 J Street, and we saw a financial return from that. Our next area of interest, which is a large block of interest, no pun intended, is the sale of 341, 345, and 347 Madison Avenue, and either an outright sale or some other kind of sale where either we turn over the responsibility of development to someone else or we share in that development with somebody else, to the tune of hundreds of millions of dollars that we would put into our capital program. And we're aggressively advancing that, and we're moving to vacate all the people out of 347 Madison. The Metro North people will go to a Gray Bar building immediately adjacent to Grand Central Terminal. The rest of the MTA headquarters will move down to the building that we lease, have a long-term lease at 2 Broadway in Lower Manhattan. And we expect those moves to occur about a year from now.
I appreciate the patience of my colleagues. Normally, I enjoy listening to them answer. I ask most of the questions, so I appreciate your patience. Do you feel it's your duty to do everything in your power with the assistance of your staff and the board to negotiate agreements with labor to avoid the self-help process afforded to labor in the Railway Labor Act, which could cause tremendous inconvenience to our constituents?
Yes. But the specific question you asked pertains to the two railroad labor unions, which have a right to strike, but it also pertains to the other collective bargaining units we negotiate with. It's important for labor and management to hammer out deals at a table such that both sides feel that they've achieved what they need to achieve, and the workforce morale needs to be where it's at. And so that's a commitment that I'm making. Whether we get there or not, it depends on a lot of different factors. But it's very important because any type of strike or job action that affects the daily service delivery that 8.5 million people depend upon will affect the economy in New York and will affect people. So it's something that both labor and management take very seriously.
Okay. Just a couple other questions. With regards to public-private partnerships, there's been discussion, studies on ways to save money through pilot projects to assess the competitive bidding process. Possibilities maybe for New York City Express. We've seen a lot of different people come up with different theories. And I was wondering if you can comment on that at this point.
I believe there's some legislation restrictions that curtail or limit what we can do in New York State. I'm familiar with public-private partnerships in the short time that I spent, 5 years of my career, 35 years in the private sector. I was familiar with them. I will tell you that there are times where a public-private partnership works. There are times that it won't necessarily work, so it's not a one-size-fits-all. But I will also say that the construction of the New York City subway, the first contract, was a public-private partnership. August Belmont bought the finance. The city basically awarded contracts, and that's how the subway system got built. So it was a public-private partnership. So I'm definitely open to the idea, but I just would say it's not a one-size-fits-all.
Right. Is there any legislative flexibility that you are requesting in order to be able to do more?
We haven't formally requested any. There's a number of different things we can do short of doing that, but I wouldn't say we wouldn't explore.
Okay. During your most recent predecessor, during his confirmation process, we asked him a question with regards to the amount of managers and supervisors listed, and there were over 66,000 employees of the MTA, and over 10,000 were listed as managers and supervisors. He was interviewed on CBS, and he took exception with that number, saying it's not accurate. But the numbers came out of the MTA's books that I read. What is accurate? Because it seems to me like the MTA is top heavy when you have over 10,000 people listed as managers and supervisors. You have 66,000 employees. He seemed to suggest that number was not accurate. Is it accurate or not? And I mean, if it is accurate, is the MTA too top heavy?
Well, I don't know whether it's accurate or not. I have to go back and take a look at exactly what was asked. Supervisors are represented employees. Hourlies are represented employees. Managers, most are non-represented, but in some of the organizations, they are represented. If you take a look at the historic ratio that is used in industry in public transportation systems, we are on par with those standards in terms of the span of control that a manager has and a supervisor has of the number of employees. I will tell you that the non-represented employees have gone 5 years without a raise. And they're the only element of our workforce that have gone 5 years without a raise. And it's creating an awful lot of pressure because many are going back to the represented ranks. Many are leaving the employ of public service and going to work elsewhere. And it's a serious problem for us. Even labor leaders will tell you you have to have management to be able to run a successful organization like ours. But I'll take a look at it.
Yeah, I wish you a lot of luck, and you have your hands full, as you know. I think Senator Gallivan would appreciate if I asked 10 more questions at this point. Everyone has some questions to ask you. When I came into office, it was at a time when the MTA was most stressed with their finances. And the MTA came to Albany and essentially asked for nearly $2 billion, and there were not enough questions asked, and the money was given. And it was done on the backs of a lot of my constituents. Now, it's important that whatever you do going forward, when you talk about cutting costs, it's not done, obviously, in a way that is drastically increasing fares. It's not dramatically cutting services. And obviously, you have your hands full because you're in the process of collective bargaining. All I say is this. I look forward to working with you. But I definitely would never want to be in a position where you as chairman are coming to us as the legislature, at least while I'm here, that you guys are ever asking for money without any questions asked. that wouldn't happen while we're here. And I appreciate you answering all these questions, and I guess we'll have more during the term, which hopefully lasts more than a year or two.
Look forward to continuing the dialogue.
Thank you, Senator Zeldin. Senator,
provide an update.
I'm sorry?
Can you provide an update on second track?
Yeah, there are three projects that we would like to go forward with in terms of resiliency and in terms of providing a better means of capacity in the event that a storm resulted in the loss of an element of the system. There's a number of reasons why a second track between Farmingdale and Concord would be beneficial to the Long Island Railroad. Just in terms of service reliability today, instead of being dependent on a single track, it would be much better. But in the event that we had an earthquake where the South Shore structure was affected, you couldn't provide service, and you would have those people want to come to the main line of Concoma, we'd need a second track. So it's our intention to be able to pursue the use of resiliency funds to fund that. Phase one is already funded the existing capital program. Phase two, we intend to have in the next capital program to have it done. But if we can accelerate the project by using resiliency funds to do so, that's what we would do. It's an important, very critical, important project for Long Island. And as we see intra-island travel increase, which we think we will see, people from Nassau to Suffolk, Suffolk, Nassau, and that's just even coming into Manhattan, it's essential. I mean, it was essential when I was there as a need, it's essential now.
Thank you, Chairman. And thank you for your efforts in the last year. It's a monumental effort here as part of the budget process for us to try to get a significant amount of funding pushed up in the timeline. And I know our chair here at the Transportation Committee did a lion's share of work to get that done. So thank you.